Thank you. This morning. Father, it's good to serve you today. It's good to be in the house of God. How good it is, oh Father. Feel your spirit and just enter in. Bless us today, Father. You may accept our sacrifice of worship and praise. Bless us, people, Lord. They are good people. They're faithful. Hallelujah. Let your light shine upon them. Glory to God. Lift us all up together today. Open our hearts to thy word, oh God, we might receive with gladness the engrafted word which is able to save our soul. We thank you for Lord in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Down at the cross where thank you.
Acts 19, 1 through 12. Acts 19. Got some stuff in the Bible, I can't.
Good to have the great David Harshman.
Yes, it is. Good to see you.
Preach it, Harshman, preach it.
Acts 19.
My favorite people, praise God's earth. There's
this is Jennifer. 19. 1 through 12. Okay, I got it. Everybody there?
Amen.
Good to see everybody this morning. Little day. Dennis, good to see you again this morning. Good to see everybody. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Amen.
I'll start. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper, Apollos came to Ephesus and finding certain disciples.
He said unto them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And they said unto him, we have not so much as heard that we believe in the Holy Ghost.
And he said unto them, unto what then were ye baptized? And they said, unto John's baptism.
Then said Paul, John really baptized with baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus.
When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus.
And when Paul and his hands came upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied.
And all the men were about 12.
He went into the synagogue and stayed boldly for the space of 3 months, disputing and persuading the things concerning the kingdom of God.
But when divers were hardened and believed not, but spake evil of that which were before the multitude, he departed from them and separated the disciples, disputing daily in the school of one Tyrannus.
And this continued for the space of 2 years. So that all the nations of the nation heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks.
And God wrought special miracles by the hand of Paul.
So that from his body were brought into the sick, handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from him, and the evil spirits went out of him.
Amen.
Amen. Pastors may be dismissed.
Sons of God, march forward.
Thank you.
thank and praise the Lord today. I thank him for his mercy and his grace and his goodness. I thank him because he is altogether lovely. He is easily to be entreated. He is always with me. No matter where I'm at, no matter what I'm going through, he is always with me. He is my comforter. He is my keeper. He is my friend. And I could not make it in this world without him. He is my all in all. He is my everything. And I want him to know that I appreciate him and I thank him. And I'm so glad that I know who God is. It is good to know who the Lord God is. You know, a lot of people know about God. They've heard about God. They've seen things that God has done, but they do not know him. It is good today to know God. I know that I know that I know that I know him, I know her. As my late mother-in-law used to say all the time, I know that I know that I know him, I know her. That God is real. If you do not know God today, I want you to know him.
Hallelujah.
I don't want you to know about him. I don't want you to have an experience that I've heard about what he can do. I want you today to know God. Really know him deep down within your heart. And know that no matter what comes your way, no matter what seems to be going on around you, all you have to do is turn to him and he will be there. You know what? I've never gotten a busy signal calling God. I've never been put on hold calling on God. I've never been thrown up a detour sign that says, go this way, I'm sorry, this lane is closed. God is there for you infinitely, all the time, everywhere. And I want him to know that I love him and I appreciate him. If you could today, just lift up your hands and give him just a few seconds of your time. Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, mighty God, I come before you and I praise you. And I thank you for your mercy and your grace and your goodness. I thank you, Lord, because I know that your word is true. And your word says, if you be for us, who can be against us? And if we can just believe, if we can just believe, all things are possible. Oh, I thank you today, Lord Jesus. I praise you, mighty God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, I praise you, Lord. And I ask that you would bless the word as it goes forth today, Lord God. Give us ears to hear your word and a heart to receive your word. And help us, Lord, to receive this word with gladness and write it upon the tables of our heart. Oh, I thank you and I praise you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Oh, hallelujah. You know, it's amazing how when things get tough, some people run away. And when things get tough, some people cling. You're going to be one or two of those people today. You're going to be the one or the other. When life gets rough and things get thrown at you, you're going to do one of two things. You are either going to cling to God and pray to God and put all your faith and hope in him and believe in him, or you're going to say, God is not true, I'm going my own way. You're going to do one or two things. Today I want you to know and understand there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but that way is death. God wants you to know who he is today. He wants you to know and understand that he has given you power. Listen to me. He has given you power to overcome the world and all the things that are in it. He has given you power today. And if you have not walked in that power, you need to walk in that power.
Amen.
I can't seem to get this out the way God wants me to get it out.
Come on.
But I want you to understand, there is a place in God. There is a place in God that is like nothing the world has.
That's right. Amen.
There is a place in God and a peace in God that nothing this world can even touch. There is a place in God and a peace in God that your husband and your children and your job and your finances, nothing in this world can give you. There is a place in God that only God can give. I have always said that when we are born into this world, we are born with a massive hole in the middle of our hearts. Every human being is born with a massive hole in the middle of their hearts. And the only thing that can fill that massive hole is the love and peace of God.
Amen.
The only thing that can ever fill that gap, that ever fills that hole, truly fills that hole, is God.
Amen.
People will try to fill it with the love of money. They try to fill it with their wife, or the love of a good woman, or the love of a good man. Or maybe that baby, that baby's going to just do it. That's what's missing in my life. It's that baby. Or my career. My career's just not on track. I'm just not doing the right thing. If I just had a better job, or if I just had a better house, or if I just had a better car, if something, there was just something there, it would make it complete. What they don't know or understand, there's only one thing that can make your life complete. And that complete name is Jesus.
Amen.
It's that true love of God. He says, I go away, but I will not leave you comfortless. I will send you a comforter. And that comforter will lead you and guide you to all truth. It will keep you. It will keep you in your day of trouble. It will keep you. It will lead you and it will guide you.
Amen. I would sit back here in this church, and I would pick out, I was trying to say Thursday, but I'd sit back here and I'd pick out just little things that just tick me, you know.
That's the enemy.
It's the enemy. I found that out through this wall that I've been through. But then I came up with, I went into a period of time where from my childhood, and everything I learned through my childhood, and I identified Thursday then. I was brought up in the First Seven Baptist Church, Martinsville. And what I learned in the First Seven Baptist Church is good. It just won't work. And in later years, I've been to different churches and different places. And I went to the Methodist church and learned many things there at that Methodist church. There was love there. But what at that Methodist church, what was there, won't work either. And I went to the, as everybody knows, sometimes I still go to the Nazarene Church. And there's love there at the Nazarene Church. There's good messages comes out of that Nazarene Church. But I can still sit in the Nazarene Church in the pews and I can nitpick and this and that. I don't like this and like that. But what I learned in that Nazarene Church won't work here. This will not work at the Nazarene Church. What I've learned here in this church it won't fit in any of those churches. But yet all those other churches, what you learned from them will fit here. And now that I'm back, all those other churches has got the one very thing that's missing. And the one thing that they won't let you go on is that Holy Ghost little sight backwards from where I was. Because I tell you what, it really opens your eyes to the real thing. And the real thing is right here. I'm not saying just in this.
I understand. The fullness of the Holy Spirit.
Exactly. Yeah. And I just thank him and I love him that he keeps me on. I don't mind going on those things. You know, I even said Thursday. You know, I wasn't meaning to hurt those people. But Mark sits back here and rattles in bottles and just drives me insane.
Amen.
But I love Mark. But you know what? I was letting that eat me come into this church. Or if I didn't like songs that I think I used to Georgia. And I was letting that bother me. But during this walk that I've had, the Lord, he let me take these little sights of these places, and I found out that it's right here, you know, right here. You can have all that stuff. You know, if I don't like Mark rattling the bottles, I'll go back to the handle of the bottles. Or don't be a song. It doesn't mean I'm going to put the wire for the bottle. You know what? You got to go on. You got to be...
The enemy will use whatever he can to get your sight off of God. I mean, he will use a crying baby. Many a times I have seen God really working in someone's heart. You can see, you know, the tears are flowing, and you can just see God is moving in their lives. And all of a sudden, someone will start talking or a baby will start crying. And immediately that person's attention is drawn to that distraction. And he does those things so that we can't keep our mind on him. He'll use whatever, and that's why we, as children of God and in the church, need to be very careful of some of the things. You know, honestly, if your baby's been crying for 40 minutes, you might want to go into the bathroom and find out what's going on. Because, I mean, honestly, there are some things that are distractions to us. And as Brother Pat says, don't be all, if your baby's crying, you know, hey, don't leave the church. You know, go back to him, try to figure out what's going on. Stand up, walk him around, pat him. I can't tell you how many babies I have carried in this church, patting them on the back, popping them up and down, you know, in my time of serving God, just to keep them quiet. It's okay. They're babies. That's what they do.
That's right. There's probably people, Sister Jennifer, that I annoy when I keep saying, what page is it?
Amen. Amen.
I can nitpick.
But we all do things unintentionally. We all do things unintentionally because we're human and we do those things. We do those things. But the enemy, his job is to kill, steal, and destroy. His job is to get our minds off of Christ and off of the Word and into our flesh. Because face it, your flesh will lead you astray. The spirit man will lead you to God. The spirit man will lead you to God. Your flesh is going to lead you astray. And that's why I was saying, you really need to know God. If you could be in church for 40 years and never have a really true experience with God. I mean, there are people who have had marriages put together. You know, I can't remember what that's called, but prearranged marriages. They've had prearranged marriages, and they put them together. And they live together for the rest of their life, never having one ounce of love toward one another. Because it was arranged. It was just the way it was. And it's sad because they've never really known the love of a husband, or they've really never known the true love of a wife, because it was just an arranged thing. It's something that you do. You know, I don't want a prearranged marriage with God. I don't want to follow after God just because someone said so. Just because it's the right thing to do. Well, the right thing to do in our family is to go to church on Sunday. Amen. That's the right thing to do. But if you're only doing it because it's the right thing to do, what experience are you having with God? You need to know who He is. You have to have that experience. And that's what Paul was trying to tell these men. I want to back up just a little bit into the 18th chapter. See, Paul had been going and ministering, and he had been preaching, and he had been teaching, he had been talking to them, and he was getting a lot of trouble. I mean, people were after him left and right. You got to stop this. This is blasphemy. I mean, he was running for his life most of the time. And it came a point in time, and it, go to verse 19, 18 and 9. 18 and 9. Then spake the Lord to Paul in the night by a vision, be not afraid, but speak, hold not thy peace, for I am with thee, and no man shall set thee to hurt thee. For I have much people in this city. God came down. God came down and he spoke to Paul and he said, listen, Paul, don't be afraid. You speak what I give you to speak. Yes. Don't worry about what people are saying. Don't worry about how many people you make upset. Don't worry how mad they are. You speak what I tell you to speak, and no hurt will come to you. My hand is on you. I'm going to take care of you. And he sat and he began to speak, and he was preaching the word, and every day he went into the synagogue. And you have to understand, he was going into the synagogues preaching Jesus. And that was not something you did. Now, it was okay to go in and read the story of Elijah, and it was okay to read from the Psalms, and it was okay to read from the Proverbs, and it was okay to read from the Old Testament. It was okay to read that. But you come into the sanctuary, and you're telling us about the Messiah? Jesus? This man, Jesus, you're saying he's the Messiah? See, they didn't understand that. He was trying to draw us. You know what? It's so strange you say those things, because he was trying to draw people out of a religion. He wanted them to know that it had been fulfilled. The Old Testament promises that the Messiah was coming had been fulfilled. He was trying to show them a new thing. They didn't want a new thing. They liked the thing they had. They didn't want anything else. They were happy where they were at. Did not want any changes. I don't like change. I like this like it is. And he said, but you don't understand. The Messiah has come. And he began, he went and he spoke of the many miracles that Jesus had done. And he showed them how in the Old Testament it said, and he will do this, and he will do this, and he will do that, and he's going to come from there. And he began to preach those things. And they didn't like it. And he began to have threatening messages. Get out of the synagogue, or you're not going to live. I mean, can you imagine all the threats that were coming against him? And I'm sure he was human, just like you and I are. And when somebody says, get out of town or we'll boil you in oil, you're going to find your hands on this, you know, all kinds of horrible threats. And God came to him and he said, don't back up. Don't back up on you, it's true. You know what's true. You know what's right. You know what's right.
Amen.
You just continue preaching. You continue speaking the word. You keep going. You keep doing. My hand of protection is ready. I got a lot of people backing you up. There's a lot of people in here. And I want you to know and understand, we're not in this alone. God's got your back.
Amen.
God has got your back. He is here for you. He's following after you. He's around you. And you know what? You're not out here by yourself. You got a lot of people out here that will stand right beside you. And they will stand beside you and they will hold up your hand. You know, when Moses began to get in trouble, what did they do? They came in and they held up his hands.
Yes.
They held up his hands. You know, and that's what we have to do to one another in the spirit.
Amen.
Now go to verse 19. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus, and finding certain disciples, he said unto them, have ye received the Holy Ghost since ye believed? Now, isn't that a strange question to be asking a disciple? I mean, this disciple was preaching Jesus. This disciple was preaching the Messiah has come. Do you understand that? He was preaching. These disciples were preaching Jesus, the Messiah has come. And Paul says unto them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And you know what their answer was? And they said unto him, we have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. What is this Holy Ghost that you're talking about? And I'm not a church basher in any way, because I believe they all, to their own God, they stand or fall. They walk the walk, they walk the, exactly where God wants them to be. I have no problem with that. You, as long as they're preaching Jesus Christ, I have no problem with that at all. You walk your walk. These disciples didn't know any Holy Ghost. They never experienced any Holy Ghost. They didn't have any understanding of Holy Ghost. We've not so much as even heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. And he said unto them, unto what then were ye baptized? And they said, unto John's baptism. Okay, if you're a disciple, what makes you a disciple? Well, because we were baptized under John's baptism. John's baptism was just repentance. Come and repent, come and repent. That's John's baptism. But when Jesus came with the fullness of the Godhead. Do you understand? He came because he was God in the flesh, walking on the face of the earth, doing miracles upon miracle upon miracle. And when he was crucified, he died that we might live.
Amen.
They had heard of Jesus. Do you understand? They had heard of Jesus. They knew of his miracles. They knew what John had said. John had told, he's the Messiah. They were baptized unto repentance, but they were not baptized in the name of Jesus. And some people are going to like this, and some people aren't going to like this. But I'm telling you, there's something about that name.
Amen.
There's something about that name. I was not baptized unto Peter. I was not baptized unto Paul. I was not baptized unto Apollos. I was not baptized unto John. I was baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Because I want you to know and understand that all power in heaven and earth is in the name of Jesus. If you do not have Jesus, you do not have God. I'm sorry. Be mad. I'm sorry. There is only one name under heaven and earth by which we must be saved, and that name is Jesus.
Amen.
I can only give you what God gives me. I can only give you what God gives me. Then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amazing. The moment they heard, John's baptism was that the Messiah has come. When they heard Jesus is the Messiah, now you have to be baptized. You have to go down to receive that power. You have to accept him. And all that comes with him. I'm telling you, there's something about that name. And there's something about having the infilling of the Holy Ghost. If you have never in your life experienced the speaking of tongues, if you have never experienced speaking in tongues and the fulfillment that I'm talking about, you feel like I'm going to fly away. If you have never felt that, oh, you need to feel that.
Amen. I had a gal in here this Thursday night that I never had been around none of that. We prayed for her. And she said, oh, we got to pray in tongues for her. I already ran out of my eyes. She said, I about ready to run. I said, no, you wasn't. She said, I never had a feeling like that in my life.
You know, it's an amazing and overwhelming feeling.
Hallelujah.
It's something you can't even describe. You can't describe that feeling. And once you've experienced that, once you've had that feeling, there's nowhere to go. I'm telling you, there's nowhere to go. You can try going back out in this world. You can try going back out and experiencing everything that they have. But I'm telling you right now, you can run, but you can't hide.
There you go.
Because once God has filled you with his spirit, You can't get away from it. You can suppress it. Do you understand? Because the spirit is subject unto the prophet. You can suppress that spirit. You can cover it with all kinds of things. But I want you to know and understand, if I have a boil on my hand, I can put 15 band-aids on that boil, but I know it's still there. I know it's still there. Every time I get into the wrong position, oh man, it's going to hurt. It's the same way with the Holy Ghost. You get into something you're not supposed to, and then that Holy Ghost will start moving to say, get out of there. Get out of there. You're not supposed to be there. You know this is not where you're supposed to be. That Holy Ghost will begin to move, and man, it hurts. Because sometimes you just don't want to hear that Holy Ghost. Am I right? Sometimes you just don't want to hear him. I'm mad. I want to be mad. I have a right to be mad. I don't want to hear you. You know you got. You just got to chill. Now look at their perspective. You got to look at that person. I don't want to be mad. I don't want to forgive them. I want to be mad. I'm going to be mad. And the Holy Ghost is saying, you know what? You're only hurting yourself.
That's right.
What is that called? It's like kicking against the bricks. I'm mad. I'm going to be mad. And the Holy Ghost is saying, no, you're not. You're not going to stay mad. I'll get mad over things. And I'm just fuming. The next thing I know, I'm just like, oh, stupid things. I don't know why I think, you know. The Holy Ghost will come in, and sometimes it might take 2 weeks. Sometimes it takes years.
It's just like Paul said, Jennifer said, or Paul even said, where I go to do good, evil is present.
Oh,
no matter how much good we try to do, there's always going to be evil present. You know?
Always. And we're constantly fighting this good fight. Always fighting. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied. And all the men were about 12. This is where I have I can't understand the world. This right here, I can't understand the world and how they say tongues are not for us. I can't understand how people can say tongues are not for us. They're not for us in this day. If Paul says it, and he says, and they say, I have not even heard of the Holy Ghost, and he said, here, have the Holy Ghost. He laid hands on them, as you said you did the young woman, laid hands on them, and they began to speak in tongues, and the Holy Ghost began to move. How can you deny it? How can you deny what you feel?
Exactly.
How can you deny what you feel?
Yep.
Oh, hallelujah. And he went into the synagogue and spake boldly for the space of 3 months, disputing and persuading things concerning the kingdom of God. He was not backing down. God told him to go. You speak the truth. You speak the truth. Doesn't matter if they like it. Doesn't matter if they accept it. Doesn't matter. You speak the truth. I'm going to be with you all the way. I'm going to be with you all the way. But when divers were hardened, believed not, but spake evil of the way before the multitude, he departed from them and separated the disciples, disputing daily in the school of one Tyrannus. You know, there comes a point in time when God says, okay, they've hardened their hearts and they're not going to listen. There comes a point in time when people just harden their hearts and they say, I don't care what you say. I don't care what you do. I don't care what happens. I'm not changing my mind. I am steadfast in the way I believe, and I don't care what you do. I'm not changing it. See, Paul stayed as long as God told him to stay. Paul stayed and Paul spoke. And Paul did exactly what God told him to. Until it came a point in time, you know, Jesus said, cast not your pearls before the swine, lest they trample them under. And that was a warning to us. You know what? When you talk to somebody and you witness to somebody, and when it gets to the point to where every time you witness, they're hurting your spirit, Every time you go to them, all you get is just a hard time. They don't want to hear you, and they're constantly throwing it back in your face. They don't want to listen to anything. You know, that's a time then you just have to be quiet. You have to be quiet and let God take care of the rest of it. There comes a time when we just have to say, okay, God, they're in your hands. And that time came for Paul. He said, when divers were hardened and they believed not, but spake evil of the way before the multitude, he departed for them and separated the disciples. He separated them. Do you understand? He sent them out. They had a job. They had to go, okay, we've done our job. We've done our work. Now you need to go where you need to go. And he separated them and he sent them out into different areas, disputing daily in the school of one Tyrannus. And this continued by the space of 2 years, so that all they which dwell in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jew and Greek. And God wrought special miracles by the hand of Paul. So many miracles. Paul was so full of the Holy Ghost. God was so full of the word. Paul was so full. He was so overwhelmed that, can you imagine this? So that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the disease departed from them, and the evil spirits went out. They literally came and said, can we have a piece of your clothing? Can we have that handkerchief, that one you wiped that sweat off with? Can we have that handkerchief? And they took the handkerchief and they laid it on the sick. And those who that were sick and those who were ill immediately recovered. The power that was in him. Do you understand? I can't imagine taking my scarf off and throwing it out in the middle and somebody that was sick instantly was healed. Paul was an amazing man. And he had such amazing power. Not in himself. Not of him. Paul in himself was nothing. He was least. He's like, I'm my least. But yet, his faith and his walk with God was so amazing that they actually took aprons and handkerchiefs and they carried them around, that when they touched those who were diseased, did it completely. Can you imagine being a leper? Having leprosy and your bones are showing and you're dying, and they lay this cloth on you and instantly you're renewed. I want to read on because I want you to know and understand that not everyone that says, I am of God, is of God. Not every person that says, well, I'm a good Christian. Are you? Do you really know Christ? Have you really had that experience with him? Or are you just going on what somebody else says? 13. Then certain of the vagabond Jews, exorcists, took upon them to call over them which had evil spirits, the name of the Lord Jesus, saying, we adjure you by Jesus, whom Paul preaches. And there were 7 sons of one, I can't say this word, city, a Jew, and chief of the priests, which did so. And the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you? Who are you? I know Jesus. I know what he's done. I know Paul. I know what he's done. But who are you? Who are you? This is an evil spirit talking. Who are you? Who do you think you are? I'm not going nowhere. And the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them and overcame them and prevailed against them, so that they fled out of the house naked and wounded. Not all that says I am of God is of God. Not everyone that calls themselves Christian is Christian. Because the word Christian means to be Christ-like, to follow after Christ. You know what? These men were not in it that they might see souls saved. They were in it. They were profit for themselves. They were in it all for themselves. They had heard about it, and they thought, maybe I'll try that. Sounds like a good thing. I bet I can do that. Oh, they were so wrong. They were so wrong. And this was known to all the Jews and Greeks also dwelling at Ephesus. And fear fell on them all. And the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. And many that believed came and confessed and showed their deeds. Many of them also, which used curious arts, brought their books together and burned them before all men. And they counted the price of them and found it 50,000 pieces of silver. So mightily grew the word of God and prevailed. Do you understand? Not everyone that calls themselves Christian is Christian. Not everyone out there is out there to do a service for God. Some people are out there just that they might profit monetarily, that they might profit with a big name, just that they might be idolized by other human beings. Paul was not that way. Paul's entire life was that others might come to the understanding of who Jesus Christ was.
Amen.
He wanted them to know who God was. He wanted them to know that the Messiah had come, that the promise had been fulfilled. And that the promise that Jesus says, I will send you a comforter. And that Holy Ghost, he will keep you. He will keep you. He will lead you and he will guide you to all truth.
Amen.
If you have not had that opportunity, if you've not had the opportunity to know God, I mean really know who he is, a daily walk with him, if you have not experienced that wonderful indwelling of the Holy Ghost in your life, if you have not had that opportunity, you need to have that opportunity. You need to take it. You need to find a time to steal away with God and get close to him. It can be at this altar. It can be beside your bed. It can be leaning beside your bathtub. It can be in your backyard sitting in a chair. It can be in the woods down beside a tree. God, I only caution you when you're driving your car. I will caution you while driving your car. Because I will, the voice of experience, tell you, driving your car while in the Spirit can be a dangerous encounter. Because I have went 5 miles out of my way before I come to myself and go, oh my gosh, I forgot to drive. How did I get here? How did I get here? I was carried away. I was carried away with God. So I caution you, if you get close to God and you're driving your car, pull over to the side and continue on. Continue on. But it can be a dangerous encounter to drive 5 miles not knowing where you've been, how you got there. God is wonderful.
Amen.
He is loving and kind and compassionate and merciful.
Yes.
And what he wants for his children is to know him. You know, the saddest thing in the world is to have your child grow up and really not know who they are. Really not have any idea what their hopes and desires are. Not really know anything about them. And those parents who know their children are those parents who've taken time to know their children. They didn't sit in front of a TV and say, just leave me alone. Just leave me alone. They talk to them every day. What's going on in your life? What's going on? You want to be a good parent? Know your child. Know what's going on in their life. Talk to them. Know them. Because if you want them to know God like you know God, then you have to let them see those things happen in your life. I just thank you today and I praise you for all this.
Good. You're the champ, I guess, right? Thanks for with us today. We didn't get to come to dinner last night. And I've had lots of illness challenges. These folks know all about it. They've been carrying me for the last several months here, really. And I think that's the first one we missed in probably 25 years, I guess. And I miss school, I do. But it was kind of a last minute thing, and everybody else was tied up, seemed like. And I hope everything went well for you guys. Always get a blessing. And we love the work the Gideons do. We endorse their ministry. And normally, we have a sing or something, we raise a little money, and then we let them have a open Bible, and so we end up with a pretty good gift. And we're not going to do that this time. we're going to pass this offering basket. Too many people sneaking past the guy and getting busy talking to the preacher back there. And, they need your money. We need this. It's a great work. It's a great work. I've heard dozens and dozens of stories of people that have went to a motel, actually in their life. I think one told us last year, and find reach over in that drawer and find that Gideon Bible there, and begin to read it. And God get a hold of their hearts and find salvation. And it's a wonderful thing. You can't replace that. We're glad little Jeff Dumpy is with us today. Who's going to? Yeah, let's get the money. You're coming in now. Okay. See, I'm not sure. We'll get you on the floor to do this for the day, okay? Because you can't. I need somebody to send for me.
Ben Lark.
Thank you.
there you go.
Then go, Tammy.
You got preached on and you still doing it.
Sing, Tammy.
But you did say, if we did, we might fall. He didn't tell me, he'd hear complaints I whispered. But he did say, if we did.
Thank you.
Sister Dot.
Attendance this morning was 68, and the tithes and offerings was $720. Wow. Oh, yes. Brother Jeff. I forgot. I'll let Brother Pat.
All right, Brother Jeff, come on and do this thing your way. You know how to do what you want to do.
Most wanted list. This is the testimony of Mary Kay Beard. Sometimes I wish I could take credit for that. A notorious safecracker and bank robber. She and her husband were hardened criminals. They're the kind of people that you go to, you visit in the jail, and they're grim. All they think about is getting their way and how they're going to get the next advantage over somebody else. Very hard. Killers. Finally, she was arrested. Mary Kay Beard was arrested and locked in an Alabama jail. And there, she found a Gideon Bible, like this one, except the hardcover was missing because they don't allow the hard in the jail. She found a Gideon Bible, and she put it under her mattress. I don't know why. But one day, she took it out, began reading it. I think maybe she put it under her mattress to hide it so she wouldn't have to think about it or see it. I think the Lord was already working on her heart. Somebody else had been praying for her. Certainly the Lord was praying for her. But one day she took it out. She began reading God's Word. She was drawn to a verse in Ezekiel chapter 36. A new heart also will I give you. She had a heart of stone. Her heart was a very, very hardened, very cold person. But the Lord says, a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh. And quietly on the floor in her cell that night, Mary Kay Beard surrendered her life to the Lord. She read God's Word. God moved in her heart and gave her a new spirit.
Amen.
Praise God. Mary Kay felt the problems of other prisoners, particularly their loneliness. And now she is blessed that God has used her in his ministry of the as an instrument to begin an angel tree ministry in the prisons, helping prisoners and their families. Someone in church, like you, bought that Bible that Mary Kay Beard, that the Lord used to save Mary Kay Beard. Thank you for that. The Gideons the Lord is doing exciting things through the Gideons International, more and more and more. We are, I believe the last time I was here, I reported that we were in something like 190 or 188 countries around the world. We're in 196 countries around the world out of just a little over 200. There are over 300,000 home missionaries around the world, in countries all around the world, eager to distribute God's Word. thank you for purchasing and being faithful to purchase Bibles so that these missionaries can get them in the hands of folks around the world. We did miss you last night at the Pastor's Appreciation Banquet. It was a fantastic time. The speaker did a great, great job. It was extremely inspiring. And I want to share a little bit with what he shared. He went on an ISB, International Scripture Blitz, to the Philippines. It was funny. He had slideshows. He's a giant of a man, 6'3 or something, and about as wide as a barn door. But his face was just always glowing, and he had these slide presentations of him and these little Filipinos that came up to right about his belly button, and he's towering over them, or he'd be surrounded by these little Gideons that looked like, you know, middle school kids, basically, except with older faces. So it was pretty neat to see. But he told about that International Scripture Blitz, and he had a picture of the 24 people from around the world, Gideons from around the world, that converge in the Philippines. And they met with the local Filipinos there, the local Gideons from, I'm trying to remember some of the figures, I probably shouldn't even say them, but basically these Gideons from around the world came and met with the local Gideons, and their goal was to distribute in the Philippines 1 million copies of God's Word in 2 weeks' time. So they had, God was moving in a mighty way during that time, and there were many Gideons that came, and this is not an easy thing to do in the Philippines. That's one thing our speaker kept stressing, was that nothing was easy in the Philippines. There's a lot of persecution, a lot of pain and suffering for those that desire to obey the Lord. However, as it is in so many dark countries, spiritually dark countries, when the light shines, then people are attracted to it. And God was moving. There was much, much prayer. The wives of the Gideons had been praying for this, for this particular International Scripture Blitz for a long time, many months. The Gideons there in the Philippines had been praying and planning for it for over a year, and God had blessed in tremendous ways. They ended up distributing that small handful of men, relatively small. I believe there were 40 or 50 men, Gideons from the local, plus the 24. So they had less than 100 men that in 2 weeks' time, I think it was 2 weeks. They might have stretched on to three. But anyway, their goal was 1 million. They distributed 1.6 million copies of God's Word.
Wow.
And they came back with story after story after story, of testimony after testimony after testimony of God loving on His children and bringing brothers and sisters. Jesus, when He comes, deserves to have many, many people.
Right.
To meet Him and to greet Him and to be with Him, because He loves us and wants to spend forever with us. I'm sorry I was late. My information was wrong. I thought the service started at 11, so I apologize. But I was really grateful to be here while the speaker, I didn't see her, but while she was, oh, there you are. She was talking about knowing God, and I want to give you, if you don't mind, just a very brief testimony of myself. I grew up in Bloomington, Indiana, and my parents were pillars in the church. Dad was chairman of the deacons most of the time, and my mom played the organ and the piano, if church was open, we were there, and if church wasn't open, we were still there, cleaning and mowing and, you know, everything. And so I grew up in a fantastic home. But when I got into high school, I began to get in with the wrong crowd. And I began to enjoy the pleasures of the world, in particular, drugs. But I had been a Christian. I had given my life as a small child to the Lord. It just made sense to me, what He says in God, in His Word, that the world is corrupt, but that He loves us. He made us for a purpose, to be with Him, now and forever. And I knew this, I saw this early on, but the drugs, the lure of the world had gotten hold of me, put some hooks in me, and I was going down a bad path. Finally, right before I was getting ready to take some seriously bad drugs, some acid in particular, as the Lord works in this way, my parents found out. And this hurt me a lot. Because I saw it hurt them deeply. And it hurt me because I love them. So I spent the next 9 months of my life crying myself to sleep, reading God's Word every night, looking for answers. I wanted to know. And I started to question God. And I said, are you real? In your Word, you say that I have to love you with all my heart. This is the great commandment. This is the thing everyone must do. It's a commandment. You cannot escape this. And so I was torn by that. I was torn up. I'm going, how can I love somebody that I don't know? I don't see you. I don't hear you. Where are you? Lord, if you are real, make yourself known to me. I believe you are real, and I'm expecting you to make yourself known to me. And if you don't, then you don't exist, and this is all a hopeless cause, and why are we even alive? And so all of these thoughts were going through my mind. And the Lord began to speak to me in the quiet of, as the speaker was saying earlier, in those quiet moments. And the Lord began to show me things, and I would read his word, and I would ask him questions, and he began to show me insights. And I was praising God, my relationship with God started to develop, and I started to know God.
Man.
Of course, he knew me inside and out, so he didn't need to know me. He already knew me, but I started to know him, and I started to hear his heart. And the first time, if this happened to you, like so many people that I've talked to, the first time you read the Old Testament, what's your impression of God? That he's kind of angry, that he's kind of judgmental, that he's kind of annoyed with us. I started reading through, what's that? Yeah, exactly. I started reading through the Bible. And I've read through the Bible many, many times now. But I started reading through the Old Testament again. This time, he was opening my eyes up to what he was really like. He loved us, and he gave us chance after chance after chance. He gave the Israelites just over and over and over. It's like me parenting my children. I hate to discipline them. I just want them to do good. I just want to support them. And I know the Lord was looking at that way about us throughout all of time.
Sure.
And he was looking at me that way, and that was encouraging to me. So I wanted to share that with you, because this verse in John chapter 17, and I'll read the first few verses of the high priestly prayer. You know, Jesus is getting ready to go to the cross. And this is one of the last times he gets to spend with his disciples before they go to the garden. And he says in John chapter 17, these words spake Jesus, and lifted up his eyes to heaven, and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you. As you have given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given to him. And this is the verse I love so much. And this is eternal life, that they would know you, the one true God, and Jesus Christ whom he has sent. That they would know you. And this encouraged me so much that I realized that I could know God. And I could walk with him. I can drive on the road and enjoy God's presence. I can be praying for the travelers next to me. I'm a member of a church in Mooresville, and one of the elderly men stood up at one Wednesday night prayer meeting and confessed that, and you wouldn't know this to know this gentleman, he was just a man of love. Every time you met him, his heart was just beaming with love for you, and it just made you feel so good to be around him. But he stood up one time and confessed, you know, when I get in the car and I get on the road, I'm tempted to just be annoyed at people. And I was thinking, I know exactly what you're talking about, John, because I am too. What is up with that? Where's my heart of love? God loves these folks. And why shouldn't I? And so I wrestled with that. And And it was encouraged me to hear that somebody else was having trouble, the same kind of trouble, because the Lord was convicting me of sinful thoughts when I was annoyed with people on the road. That's not right. So I'm sorry, I'm not talking about the Gideons, but I wanted to share with you a little insight as to what the Lord has done for me. I'm thinking it might encourage you. And this other scripture too, from 1 John chapter 3, is one that encourages me so much. I wanted to read it for you, and I'm sure you're intimately familiar with it. 1 John chapter 3, for just a few verses here. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God.
Amen.
Therefore the world knows us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now we are the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. We don't yet know what that means, necessarily. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him just as he is. And every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. And you guys are familiar with the Gideons. One of the things I really want to do is stress that God doesn't really do anything unless he does it through his people. The Lord makes that clear in the Old Testament. He talks about not doing anything unless he sends a prophet to let it be known what he's going to do. And I believe that the Lord is moving through us. And whenever we do something good, like pray for somebody like the Gideons, or we're driving by and we see a hotel, we pray that the manager would allow the Gideons in there, that we pray for the hotel Bibles that are sitting there, because there are so many people that go to hotels to take their lives. We hear time after time, the Gideons get thousands of correspondents every month at Tennessee with testimony. Many of them are from testimonies of people going to the hotel to kill themselves. And they pick up a copy of God's Word, and the Lord saves them.
Amen.
It is exciting. So I want to encourage you to pray. There's one thing that encouraged me greatly. As you're familiar with the scripture in the Old Testament and the New Testament, where he's quoting the Old Testament, where Paul is quoting saying, there is no one who does good. No, not one. And the first time I read that, I thought, well, that makes sense. But then I was tempted to be kind of hurt by that, because, wait, I see good, and I find myself actually doing good. There are times when I actually do something selflessly. It's rare, but it happens. And I realized that I was really encouraged to realize that that was God working in me to do something good. When I saw somebody loving me, letting me in traffic, or praying for me, or smiling at me, I thought, that is the Lord loving me, expressing love to me, and doing good for me, and doing good in others. And so, I want us to know and appreciate the fact that when something good is happening, when you feel compelled to pray for your pastor, or for driving by the church, these other congregations, and you're praying for them, realize that is God working in you.
That's right.
And then the next logical conclusion is that he is going to see that it happens.
That's right.
Because he has made this prayer for you. He has petitioned. And he is going to, and you can have faith that God is going to do it. And I want you to pray for the Gideons in faith. And when you find yourself praying for the Gideons, appreciate the fact that God is there, and he is going to do good things. And he's going to do, and he's doing them through you. And this is extremely encouraging to me. One of the testimonies that we had last night, extremely powerful testimony, I want to share with you, as our speaker related it. There is a man, and I forget his name, but some of you may know him. He is the man that God used in a mighty way to start the Jesus is Lord Church in the Philippines. This church is now a multinational church and has over 6 million people in the congregation. And that is exciting. In those dark countries, people come to God. When Jesus is lifted up, men come to Him. People come to Him. And so, but the way that this gentleman got started, the way the Lord got a hold of him, is a fascinating story, and I want to relay it for you, because it too is typical of the Gideon testimony. And I wish I remember. I wish I could remember his name. But he found himself, he was a very wealthy man, even in his youth. He had everything in the Philippines. He was one of the top guys. Had all kinds of money. Had a wife, a child, small child, a son. But as it is with so many men who have no moral foundation, who have no, God is not holding them accountable to their own thoughts, and holding them accountable to sinful thoughts, and so on, the way working out your salvation. He didn't have the Lord in his life, so he was quickly and easily swayed into temptation. So he found himself straying from his family and getting mistresses and doing all the things that a very wealthy, powerful man would be tempted to succumb to. Well, one thing led out to another, and his empire crumbled. His wife left him. His mistresses started conspiring against him, and a group of people divided up his kingdom and left him, and he found himself in jail with nothing. Broken, crushed man. And I'm saying that with a smile because you know what it's going on. Well, eventually he got out of jail, and his sister had been traveling. And she had gone to, and I forget where she was, but she'd been in another country where she met a Gideon who was passing out God's word. And he gave her a copy of God's word. And she took it, to make a long story short, she brought it back to her brother who was in jail. And he gave it to her, she gave it to him and said, "You need to read this." And he did. And he didn't put it down. And to expedite the story a little bit, he got saved from that guy, that Gideon's testament, and founded the Jesus is Lord Church. God founded it through him, rather, I should say, to be more accurate. All because somebody like yourself spent $1.30, which is the typical cost of this, or $5 for a hotel Bible. And this will last about 6 years in the hotel. And then the covers get taken off and put into jails, by the way. God is good and amazing. Yes. We'll take a small seed and make a huge, huge thing out of it. Yes. So, I have some other encouraging testimonies for you this morning. But I want to encourage you to pray for the Gideons. That's really my main goal this morning. I feel compelled to encourage you to pray, to spend a lot of time in prayer. One of the things that I believe that is very powerful is for you to just be in the Spirit as you're going down the road in the car. I think it's fortuitous that the speaker was speaking of various things that I wanted to touch on as well. Pray for those hotels. Pray for those churches you go by. Pray for the driver next to you. And know that the Lord is doing that. Pray for the jails and the men. I drove past the county jail on the way here over here on 39. And I've spent quite a bit of time in that jail trying to minister to the inmates and passing out Gideon testaments. And so I'm praying for them as I'm going by. And I'm excited because this is God doing it. And it's not me. And He gets the credit. Amen. And so that brings me a lot of joy and delight in life. And I can see God's mind and heart and I can start to know Him better because I see how He loves those inmates. And he wants them to be free of this enslaved mind that they have, to their mean-spirited mind like Mary Kay Beard was. He loves us very, very much. Gave His life for us. And I want to encourage you to pray. I didn't get a chance when I came in because I was late, again, for which I apologize. But you'll have a card rack. I'll check to make sure it's stocked. But one of the things that we need prayer for, of course, is funds. We want the church to buy Bibles so that we can put them in the hands of people around the world. We know that those 1.6 million scriptures that were distributed in the Philippines are going to produce 1.6 million plus a manifold number of children for the Lord. Because we have this great promise in God's word in Isaiah 55:11. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void. It shall accomplish that which I, the purpose for which I have sent it, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I have sent it. Excuse me. But we have this great promise of the Lord that his word does not return void. It accomplishes what he sends it out to do. And this is very exciting. And the Gideons are not anything special, just like the Gideon in the Bible. He was not a Superman. But when he let God work through him, amazing things happened. And so that is what we are doing, the church is doing, and through the Gideons, is giving out copies of God's word, which does the work. It is God who does the work. We're simply just handing out God's word. And it is amazing how much the Lord loves us. So pray for funds also. We are still have, I believe I reported last time, and this is still the case, that we still have only enough scriptures to put into two-thirds of a lot of those school children. A lot of our distributions are in schools in those third world countries, and which is extremely exciting because the kids take the book and they read it, and they take it home, and families get saved. It's very exciting to hear that those testimonies as well. Pray for funds, though, because we only have about two, we can only fill about two-thirds of those hands. Last night, they were running out of scriptures, but they had one more school to go to, and at the last school they went to, they only had enough for 25% of the 5,000 students that were there, which is sad for us, but we're expecting God to bless nonetheless. So pray for funds. The CARD program produces about a third, 25% to a third of the funds that the Gideons get. Encourage you to continue to use this. These cards are purchased for you free of charge by the Gideons. All you have to do is donate. It's just a method or vehicle for donating scriptures and to honor someone. You have in recognition cards and thinking of you cards where you can have a versatile means of honoring someone or thinking of them. Maybe they're overseas or maybe they're in the hospital and you want to honor them. You want to encourage them. I know that if I were sick and in the hospital and somebody and a card came to me that says, $50 worth of Gideon's Bibles have been purchased, because we were thinking of you in the hospital and praying for you. I know that, and of course in memory cards, I know that at my funeral, I don't, as beautiful as those flowers are, I would much rather people spend $50, $100 instead of on wreaths and just see a little card sitting there where the flowers would be and it says $50 or $100 worth of Bibles were purchased to honor the memory of this person who is now face to face with the Lord. Can't think of a better way to be honored at a funeral than giving out copies of God's Word and others coming to know Him. So pray for funds. Use the cards, please. You can also go to the Gideon's website, gideons.org, and you can buy greeting cards there, expressions cards. Those are, you're buying a card, so I think about 20 cents of that goes to the price of the card. But the other, and they're about $4, so the rest of it buys almost three copies of scripture for one greeting card. So if you have a gift of hospitality, then by all means, take advantage of that. We'll get more scriptures into those hands of those children that are waiting. About the other third of the funds come from church presentations like this one. Gideons all over the world are barefoot on dirt floors and giving a Gideon report just like this and taking up money. pennies from those poor folks. So pray for funds. Also, pray for the Gideons. The men and women of the Gideons International need prayer. Just like your pastor needs prayer, and you and your congregation need prayer, your deacons need prayer, your leaders need prayer, to keep them from falling into sin or temptation of some kind that will hamper their ability to serve the Lord. Even so, the Gideons need prayer. We need to be men and women of integrity. We live in the community, and we need to be there for everyone that needs a copy of God's Word. We don't want to taint it with any kind of corruption on our part. So please be in prayer for the Gideons. As I said before, pray for the hotel managers that don't let us in. More and more, we're in the United States, we're not let in. Same with the schools. Pray for the hospitals, that the folks that run the hospitals will allow us to put scriptures in there, because there's a hospital distribution as well. Pray for the jail superintendents. It's amazing how many jails in our country don't want the Gideons to come in. I don't understand it. You come in with a copy of God's Word, and it's exciting. People turn their lives over. They become gentle, beautiful, loving, people in the society. Why would a jail superintendent not want that? So pray for them as well. The folks in the jail need help really bad. And Mary Kay Beard would not have this. Lord would not be moving through her in particular for this great ministry if the superintendent had not allowed the Gideon's hand to play scripture. So prayer. Please be in prayer. And the other thing, of course, is to buy Bibles. Thank you for the offering. I'll count and get a receipt to you, and you can pray for the Bibles that those are going to purchase, and expect God to do great and wonderful things. Well, I'm really excited. That was one of the things our speaker said last night. He was talking to the Gideons, and he said, "Are you guys excited about what God is doing?" And we were. The room was just excited. You look around at all these beautiful men and women were just smiling and excited. They're expecting good things from the Lord. And it is exciting to be alive in the presence of God. So it is exciting to be here, and I really enjoy worshiping with you all. And thanks a lot for having us again, and thanks for your faithful service. I know that that you are going to be really pleased with what the Lord shows you when we go home to meet Him, and He shows us the things He was doing through us that we didn't know, or that we took for granted for some time, including the purchase of these scriptures. So, thank you very much, and God bless.